Welcome back to the channel. This is the Procon Geek, and in today's video we're going to be discussing BIM design in Procon. So without wasting too much time, let's just get right into it. So please, if this is your first time coming to my channel, please just subscribe, click the subscribe button, and if you're returning, please like this video, share it, and leave a comment down in the comment box so that I know what you want to see the next time and what you like or do not like about these videos. So please remember, just subscribe. Okay, so without wasting too much time, first thing that you obviously want to do is just have your Procon up, as you can see on the screen. But before we proceed to the concrete tab, let me just take a few minutes to say that we do not use the beam and LS modules to design beams. These are basically just for analysis. This is an analysis of a single span beam, so it's basically useless. It's like a single span. It's single span is a simply supported beam, and then ELS as well, but this one is quite useful. It's analysis of a beam on an elastic support. This is what you use when you're analyzing strap beams, which you find in foundations. If you want me to do a video on strap beams, what they are and how you can analyze them, and then further on go on to design them in Procon, hit me. Please just leave a comment in the drop box below, or hit me up on WhatsApp or on the DM, and I'll definitely do that. So if you like the video, I'll definitely do that as well. Then what we need to do, or when we're designing beams, what we need are reinforced concrete beams in Procon. Where we have to go to is this beams slash slabs, continuous beam or slab, because this can be used to design flat slabs as well, because a flat slab is designed as a principle of multiple strips of beams. Now, so what you want to do is obviously click it up, and then you have your module starting up. So mine takes a little bit of time to load, so I already had it open. And to get it started, let's just get into it. We may see where we end. But let's just try and cover it as much as possible in this video. So the first thing that you're going to have is the input tab, where you have the parameters as the first thing that greets you. So the first thing that you have is FCU, which is, in this case, we're going to be using 25. Let's just change this to 25. The default is 30, but you can change it to whatever you need. Then FY, and remember, FCU, the FCU is for the cube strength if you're using BS. If you're using ACI, American Constitution Institute, whatever that is, the ACI. But if you're using that, it's a cylinder. So when you see this funny shape, don't be worried about it. It also changes if you're going to be using the Euro code. The Euro code is FCK. That is just basically another, the cylinder strength. So it all depends on the code of practice that you're going to be using. But I use BS, former British colony, so we stick to the BS and the SANS, which is South African National Standards. Anyways, okay, let's go on to the next thing that we have. We have FY, so this is the characteristic strength of your steel, right? This is the main reinforcement of your bars. As you can know, we have main reinforcement, then we have the stair wraps, all the links that are going to be holding the main reinforcement, right? That is for your shear. So the FY is for your main reinforcement, which is to take care of the moment. Then FYV is the shear strength, or the characteristic strength of your steel that you're going to be using for the links. So as you know, most people use R bars, which are mild bars, right, for the links, and they use high yield tension steel for the main bars, right? So it's obviously going to be different. So in BS, what it does, by default, it assumes you're using high yield steel for your main bars and low yield steel for mild yield steel for your bars. So, but in our case, we're going to be using 250. So, yo, bro, it's what it is. All right, this is the percentage of the bending moment redistribution that is going to be applied when Procon is designing your beams. As you know, the maximum that you can usually use is 30, but conservatively you want to stick to using 10%. So then the next thing is the downward or optimized distribution. So let's just cover this two in one go. So redistribution, what it means is basically you're redistributing the top or the hogging moments to the bending moments. So usually what happens is that sometimes, especially when it comes to columns, the moments at the top of your supports is usually very, very large. And then the steel that you need for these hogging moments is also very, very large. But in principle, when designing a beam, you want your largest steel to be at the bottom. So it doesn't make sense when you start netting Y25s at the top and Y12s at the bottom. So what you want to do is you redistribute the moment that is at the top down to the bottom, so that at least it's either the steels are a little bit comparable or you have the bigger steel at the bottom. So with the downward redistribution, what you're doing is just basically you are taking the top moment by the percentage off and then just throwing that percentage to the bending moment, which is at the center of the span. But with optimized redistribution, you're taking the 10%, then you're optimizingly redistributing, not to one point or just by saying shifting the graph down by 10%, but you're trying to redistribute all over the span, so it's a little bit more optimized. But to be conservative, what you want to do is you want to stick to D. So in this case, what it offers you is an option whether you want to go with D or O. So we're going to go with D for this one. Then the next thing you have is the cover to center top still in millimeters, which is basically the distance from the top surface of the concrete to the center of the top steel. And for the bottom, this is just the distance from the soffit of the beam to the center of the bottom steel, which is self-explanatory. Then you're going to go to the next thing. You have the DL factor and the LL factor. So these are basically L factor. So these are basically the ULS, maximum ultimate limit state, dead load factor and live load factor. For the default for BS is 1.4 with the dead and 1.6 with the live. Then the next thing that you have is the density of the concrete. So the default which you have is 24.5, but I like to use 24.5. So this is quite important when it comes to calculating self-weight of your beams. So you don't have to enter any self-weight. All you have to do is put in the density of the concrete, then the sections, and it will determine the self-weight from there. Then the next thing, you have the percentage of the live load that you want to be permanent. In this case, the default is 25. You can take it up or down depending on the code that you're using and if you have any justification, because remember, everything that we do has to be justified by a code. Then the next thing that you have is the percentage or the 30-year creep coefficient and 30-year free shrinkage strain coefficients. The defaults for the BS is 2 and 300 to the power times 10 to the power of -6. It all depends on the code, but most codes, these are the defaults, and you want to stick to this. Unless you have a special case, you can then later on use the charts that you see, where is the 30-year shrinkage and the 30-year creep coefficient, to work out the perfect coefficient that you want to use. And as you can see, it is inland South Africa, indoor UK, coastal South Africa, coastal outdoor UK. So it all depends on the exposure of the beam, where it is, and where you're going to be doing it from. Then last but not least, obviously you have the title. You can just call this the subscribe beam if you want, but then this is just basically more for aesthetics than anything as well. All right, now we're done with the parameters. The next thing you want to check out is the sections. So this is the next step that you have, and this is where you go on to define your sections, right? So the input is quite easy. The first thing that you obviously have is the section number 1, 2, 3. I'm just going to put it at 3 for now. Okay, so this is where you define this the sections that you're going to be using for each span in this program. Then BW is just the breadth of the web, because you can also make T-I sections and T sections in this case. So in the first section, what I'm going to do, I'm just going to make it a simple beam, right? So it's going to be 230 wide and 350 deep. Okay, so this is the simple beam. This is the simple beam that you have, where it's just rectangular and you have the breadth and the depth. Then in the next section, okay, also remember, D is like the overall depth of the section, whether you have flanges or you do not have flanges. Now, BF at the top, what this basically means is the breadth of the flange at the top if you have it, and HF is the same, the depth of the top flange if you have it. The same also applies to the BF bottom and HF bottom as well. So to make this a little bit more clear for you, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to put it at 50 right. Then the overall depth for this one, what I'm going to do, I'm going to put it at 500. Then the breadth of the flange at the top, I'm going to put it at 400. Then the height of the flange, I'm going to put it at 100. All right, now what you have, as you can see, you have a T section of a beam where you've defined it. This is how you define a T section, right? First of all, you define the breadth of the web. If that is in this case, you have a T section. That if you want an I section, what we're just going to do the same, and the overall depth, I'm going to put it at same. We're just going to use the same dimension that we used last time, and this time again, I'm just going to make sure that it's a symmetrical I section. And voila, as you can see, this is how you define your sections in Procon when using the section tab. Right? So if you want, you can pause the video at this moment in time to get a feel of how I define each and every one of these. And just remember, D is the overall depth of the section. In this case, yes, we've defined three sections, but we're going to be using one section only, which is six. Let's move on to see how we define our spans in this video. So for our spans, all we have to do is come up to the next tab, which says spans, and this is where you define your spans. So in our case, we had an 18 by 6 classroom block, and we were just doing ground beams, which are going to be supporting walls only. So we're going to have three spans, each spaced at 6 meters. So the next thing that you do, you enter the number of the spans, right? And then you specify the length of your sections, which is going to be 6, 6, 6, and 6. And as you can see, it automatically does that on the screen for you guys. Then the next thing that you want to do is the section for the first span. What is the section you want to be on the left side? So in our case, we're going to be using 1 and 1 throughout. That is 1 to the right, 1 to the left. So in this case, if you wanted to change the section, you could probably just say we're now using section 2 when it comes up to span 2. And if you wanted to change the section as well, you can say change, we're using the section when it comes to section 3, section when it comes to section 3. What I'm thinking is, obviously we wanted to do one single, right, for all of these sections, but let's just use up those sections. So for the first span, we're going to have section 1. For the second span, we're going to have section 2. And then for the third span, we're going to have section 3. We're just playing around with it. In real life, it's all section 1 throughout. In that case, it'll be just like 1, 1, 1, and 1. But in our case, just to make it easy and for you to visualize, we're going to be just putting different sections throughout. Now, the next thing that you want to do is now specify the types of supports that you have for your beams, right? So centering the supports is easy. You can have simple supports, fixed supports, and even column supports. So this is how we're gonna do it. In my case, I'm gonna have columns, and I'm just gonna show you how you're gonna do it. What we can do is we're gonna say support 1. What type of support is it gonna be? We're just gonna fix that part. So once we did, we fixed the first support. So we're gonna assume it's fixed at some point. Yeah, we just played around, just trying to see what we can do and what we cannot do. So in the next thing that you wanna do is you wanna specify that it's a column. So what is the depth of this column? This is gonna be 300 by 300 columns, right? The width is, right, so the D is 300 and 300. And the height of this column, I'm gonna put it 0.5 because it was a small stop. It wasn't something that was like really huge, right? And then obviously, maybe if you want a column that extends at the top, do you want a column above? No, I don't want a column above. So we are not going to be doing that. Forgive me, C is not the way to put that. C means whether it's, so F means fixed, C means cantilevered. If you want just a column, delete C, just put 300, 300 and 0.5. So please forgive me for putting C there. Now, the next thing that you want, you have 4 supports. Remember that, 3 spans, 4 supports. 3, the next thing, you're going to have a column as well. So to have this column, what are you going to do? What you're going to do is now, it's just going to be the same thing, 300, right? Then you want to put 300. And for the height as well, it's going to be 0.5 because we have the same columns throughout and everything. We have the same columns throughout and everything that goes. And same applies for, you could actually leave it as a simple support, but I want it to be restrained because we are actually building real life things. So this is going to be 300 again, 300, and then obviously you want to put 0.5. So in case you had columns above, we were just going to do this for, say, part 2 for the first step. So what we're going to do is, yes, we have a column above, and the column above, we're just going to make it the same as this, and we're going to make it 0.5. And as you can see, this is how it clearly is illustrated for you on the screen using Procom. All right, so the next thing that you want to do after defining the types of supports that you have, as you can see, this is automatically, Procon gives you a visual interpretation of these supports as you type them. The next thing that you want to do is go to the loads. Right, so now with the loads, the issue is that it gives you the first thing is whether it's a live load or it's a dead load. In our case, we did have loads because we only had the walls which we're going to be sitting on the beams, and that's what we're going to do. We're going to look at the live load in other videos, but for this case, we're going to be using the dead load only. So in this case, you specify whether it's dead, which span is going to be acting upon. So I'm just going to put 1, 2, 3, right, because we have 3 spans, it's going to have dead load. So we're going to have a constant load. For the wall load that I came up with was 21 because it was it's actually 22 because it's a wall and it's a 230 wall. This is going to be 230 walls, and this is where you're going to be. So this is how you specify if it's a uniformly distributed load. If it's a live load, you can also add the where it's P, and if it's a moment, you can also put M. But for now, we're just gonna be done with the uniformly distributed load that is going all over your walls. So this is will represent the walls. Now, the next case, if you wanna put wind load, it's up to you. But wind case, if you wanna put wind load, it's up to you. But wind load, remember, it acts underneath your beams. In our case, our beams were in the ground, so there was no wind load, so we did not have anything that we needed to put in our case. Okay, look at it. It's 15 minutes. And in this case, we looked at the parameters, the sections, the spans, the supports, and the loads. So what we're gonna do is we're just gonna drop the video right now and leave the next content for the next videos, since it's gonna be pretty long. We don't wanna make this 30 minutes or anything. So please allow me to thank you for staying in and tuning in and watching the video. Please, please leave a comment below and tell me what you think about this video. Tell me what you think we should do in the next videos. If you enjoyed this video, if it is clear or if it is not, and also please remember to subscribe to my channel if you already haven't. And until next time, stay safe, stay indoors, don't.